I saw a very large canvas. I saw a very eclectic canvas where basically we were going to make our own rules.
Art direction, set design, I think generally was one massive challenge. That evolution told us it had to be this much money, better make it on a back lot.
Michael had a saying that when Ridley takes out the pencil, it's hundreds of dollars, and when he takes out a pen, it's thousands of dollars.
Ridley was over here hunting around for people to work on this film that he'd agreed to do. I went over and had a meeting with Michael Dealey, Ridley Scott, I think Ivor Paul, and John Rogers, and got the script handed to me called Dangerous Days. Isn't it fortunate it wasn't used? And took it home and started to do sketches and started to submit work to Ridley, and then Lawrence Paul was hired. I was the first hire on the staff.
A futurist, Sid Mead, was one of the great illustrators of industrial objects, cars, electric irons, apartments, skyscrapers, cityscapes, urban development. And I looked at this, thought, looking at them as if they were fantasy. Now, Sid was actually a great preview on where we've gone now in Tokyo, I've just been to Shanghai, in Shanghai certainly, the way the urban development is going, Sid absolutely had it nailed. And I didn't know that at the time, I just felt he did. And I brought him in for a meeting and said, look, we got to do it this way. I'm going to be on the back lot. We got to do the best we can. We have a limited budget. I can't make things like Stanley took at the time, I think 2001, for the time was expensive. But he'd actually made everything, including the centrifuge wheel, and it all worked. And I would never have the budget to do that. That's why the idea of retrofitting things came about. It would have to be retroed to the surface of the back lot, which had traditional buildings, upon which we would put pipes and ducts and air conditioning. And one famous architect, years later, stopped me, brought me to his office, his rather superb office in London, and said to me, you know, we run Blade Runner about once a month, because he said, when I saw Blade Runner, the evolution of the beauty and technology suddenly became very apparent, which is where the building can wear the guts on the outside, and the guts become part of the decoration. And so that's the way we'd gone with Blade Runner. So it was by necessity we actually kind of started to design it that way.
Sid Mead, although his visual influence on Blade Runner was indeed great, was only part of a larger entity called the Art Department. Now, every film has an art department, and this is where the designs and the blueprints and the whole overall visual concept of the films is nailed before filming starts. The person in charge of the art department is called a production designer. On Blade Runner, that was a guy named Lawrence Paul, and Larry had a lot to do with hiring the other people in the art department and coordinating all of the varying looks and synthesizing them to Ridley's specification.
The big advantage we had was the famous actor's strike that lasted for months. And the fact that, because I don't think we ever would have been able to finesse the designs that we were developing in the art department, finesse the technical aspect of it, had there not been an actor's strike. We needed the time. So consequently, we were in pre-production for 9 months or 9.5 months, which is as long as I've ever been on pre-production on a film.
We went over to Sunset Gower, and he brought me into Ridley's office, and he said, oh, I want you to meet, this is David Snyder, he's going to be the art director. And Ridley took his Macanudo out of his mouth and stood up and shook hands, and he said, too bad for you, mate.
This is a rather different art department situation. Ridley's in charge of the art department on this picture, and I imagine on most pictures, but this one specifically. It's not quite fair to sound as though one's diminishing the art department or the art director or whatever, but one is, inevitably, in a way, because Ridley's so on top of it, and he's micromanaging the art department, which is probably hard for art directors to take, but okay, when the credit comes up, and it's them. those guys had to work awfully hard to do what Ridley wanted, and they had to be very efficient to do what Ridley wanted. But it was Ridley who decided what it would be.
I knew that he had been an art director, and I knew that that was probably a good thing, you know, that he understood, and it would mean that unlike some pictures where a lot of money and focus is placed on the script and the performances, which is a good thing, that a fair amount of emphasis would be placed on the look of the film.
We were evolving what the future would be with Larry Paul, who was my chosen production designer. I hadn't worked with him before. I think he thought I was absolutely crazy. But because I could draw, it would help a lot.
The three illustrators that were working with Larry Paul are Mentor Huebner, Sherman Labby, and myself. Ridley looked at absolutely everything that I drew, everything that I was proposing, and would say yes or no to it. We'd be in meetings, and he would be wanting me to have more and more variety, take more chances, be more like heavy metal, which is those Mobius strips where they're in a futuristic city and everything looks different, and it's a hodgepodge of everything. Sherman was doing was the storyboards, working very closely with Ridley Scott. Ridley would hand little tiny drawings, we called Ridleygrams, to Sherman, and Sherman would then do fairly large renderings in tone and light, and they were gorgeous. Mentor was doing the production illustrations of the sets that Larry was building.
Mentor Huebner, a grand old gentleman of the real classic movies, did his Lockoff drawings and I think Conti pencil. They're gorgeous, gorgeous drawings. I was hired to work one-to-one with a director, Ridley. He's, after all, he's God. A director is God on a film. So I worked essentially for his approval through this staff structure overlay who would then, you know, make the thing look like Ridley had approved. So it was kind of an elitist approach to being involved in the film. But I got along very well with all the staff people.
One of the troubles we got into with Sid Mead was he became so important to the film that he'd only been originally hired for a few days at $1,500 a day or something. Suddenly he was on the thing for weeks. And one factor in going over budget.
In retrospect, I guess I seduced the process of being hired in the first place only to do the vehicles. And because I could render, I've been rendering for 20 years at the time I started in the movie business. So I knew how to reproduce the mood, lighting, the fixtures, what you saw, and I had never done an isolated object on a white sheet of paper because that's not the way things exist in the real world. They have surroundings, you know, in situ. So once I designed Sebastian's truck, I have it sitting on the street. It's not being used. Behind it is a building with sort of this patched over screened windows with a cold cathode light inside. Off in the distance is sort of a misty, indistinct alignment of architecture, and it has a very, very dreary effect. And that's what I pursued all the way through, showing these vehicles in place.
Sid designed this whole world, but he designed not just what would be the map paintings, but conceived of what the streets would look like and what the neon would look like and what the lighting would look like and what it would look like when it was all drenched in grisly, oil-soaked rain, and then designed the vehicles as well. So the whole thing kind of knit together. Sid wasn't really the production designer per se, but he was the stylist.
I think it was a really smart decision to get someone who didn't have just an idea about the future, but he was actually someone who was an industrial designer and illustrator who was designing products for the future for people who were going to manufacture them.
Sid had gone into great, wonderful details about, will there be parking meters? Of course, it'll be much worse than parking meters. He developed a parking meter that would actually kill you.
The post mechanical case becomes electrified so that if you touch it or try to attack it, you're electrocuted, which is a very brutal attack on you as a human.
I said, no, Sid, that's a bit much.
The first thing to do was to design the vehicles because they take the longest, the most elaborate prop to build. So Gene Winfield made a trip down to my house in Orange County and drove down. We went over the designs. Ridley had approved them. The spinner, the taxi, the Sebastian's truck, that vehicle, and some other vehicles which were really never built because of budget problems.
They had me bid on 54 cars, and I knew that they would never be able to afford all of these cars, and I knew it would be reduced. So it got reduced to 27 cars. I had three shops going. I had as high as 50 people working on this project altogether. I had, I think it was 18 people just in fiberglass, working in fiberglass. And we worked 18 hours a day, 7 days a week for 5.5 months to produce these vehicles, because they were very involved, and you know, by the shape of them and everything, that Sid did a wonderful job designing them, but they were a little bit hard to build. They took his renderings and scaled them. They had seven people working on in the art department scaling those blueprints so that I could build the cars, and then they could build scale models of some of them to fly in the movie. Once we got started on the vehicles, then they came over to my shop, Ridley Scott and all the different people in the art department kept coming over all the time, and they were shooting pictures, and then I was shooting pictures as we went, and I was mocking up the sedan. I was using some metal, some wood, some fiberglass. And then I had a shop down the street doing the taxis. It was a carpenter shop, and so we built the taxis basically out of wood, and they were built on a VW van chassis. And then I used VW chassis for most of the smaller cars. I shortened the coupe chassis, and then I lengthened the ones for the sedan, like Harrison Ford's sedan and the police sedan. Those were all made on VW chassis, which I lengthened 12 inches. One of the spinners was a complete mock-up, of which we put on a table. Some of the dialogue was filmed in this unit, and this unit had all kinds of things working. You know, doors came up and all kinds of things moved and whatnot. And then it had all complete interior, all the gadgets and the monitors and all that. Everything was working in that unit. And that was, like I say, on a rolling table. And the actors would get in and sit there, and they'd film different sides and do the dialogue and everything on that unit. And then the one spinner that they lifted to fly, that we didn't have an engine in that, but it had everything working, all full hydraulics, you know.
I went through and then designed some vehicles from one of Ridley's wonderful contour line drawings, or a Mobius drawing or something, and presented it to him. And this was a huge toxic mobile waste dump that was big, like a fortress.
And Stephen Dane would kludge pieces and bits and parts that he found from Arizona to New Mexico, and brought all these aircraft parts and pieces here, and had his own group out at the Burbank hangar manufacturing that. As a matter of fact, Ridley liked Stephen so much that he wanted him at his side all the time with a sketchbook, and Stephen could like knock stuff out like crazy. He was the assistant art director, but he was sort of like Ridley's pet guy.
Many of the things in that movie, the umbrellas, all that, were all built at little tiny garage shops. Dream Quest, that did the readouts for the spinner dashboard, they were in a garage too, or someone's house, you know?
Everybody in the art department was tickled to work on Ridley Scott's film following Alien. Alien was a gorgeous film, the best piece of art direction I think I've ever seen in my life. And we all thought, okay, we're doing this picture about replicants and the future and a flying car. And I said, whoa, we're doing Alien too. We get to walk down that same road. Everybody got turned around at a certain point and said, no, wait, we're not doing Alien 2. We're doing something completely different. And it is the future, but it's not that far in the future.
The caveat when I was going to do the show was it was not going to be a big movie. American International Pictures was making this movie. They wanted us to eventually go to Mexico and make the movie. and I was told that the only set that I would be designing, because the rest would be all location, would be the street. Everything else was going to be done live location. And, you know, given what is going on in the film business and so forth and so on, you say, uh-huh, yes, uh-huh. By the time I got on the film, there was a location manager on the film already that the production manager had hired. And there were two locations that Ridley liked in L.A. One was the Bradbury Building, and the other was Union Station. The Bradbury Building turned out to be the hotel where one of our key characters lived, and Union Station turned out to be the police station.
where we built the set in the corner of the station, and the set is still there in Union Station. It's part of the offices now. And we made a deal with them to cut back on the location fee if they would, you know, take the set, which they did.
I think, funnily enough, it took somebody not to come from L.A. to actually do it in L.A. because I'm new, I haven't seen this before, and I'm going, wow, that's good, you know? And the Bradbury's great, and we put a little cheap canopy on. I even brought the columns from the studio because they're only styrofoam. So I had a style of crunchy kind of comic strip architecture, which is nearly real. It's real. You've got to make it real. The Bradbury building, yeah, everyone in the TV series uses that, and I said, you know, basically, shh, back off. I'm going to use it. I'll shoot it the way you hadn't seen it before.
Being an architectural student, I said, you know, it doesn't make any sense to me that you're walking along the corridor of the Bradbury building and all of a sudden you walk in and there's these plaster walls. And I said, it doesn't make any sense to me. And I mean, that was exactly the point. And why does it have to make sense? And isn't it so much more interesting that the architecture is different? And I think what he said to me was, don't rationalize with me. Michael Dealey said, okay, it's 3 o'clock, Ridley's gonna come. I want all the drawings up on the wall, he's gonna come and look at all the drawings. So in those days, you had to go to the blueprint shop and make copies, which was like interminable in time. And everything smelled of ammonia because they just came out of the machine. So the whole room stank of ammonia with these drawings that had just been put up. So Michael Dealey and Ridley were walking around, and I was standing with Larry Paul like this, you know, terrified, and walking around looking at the drawings. And as if we had left the room, he looked at Michael and he said, well, you know, it's never really all what you want, is it? He said, it's you never get what you want. Because there was so much to do, and I think at the peak we had 400 plus minus carpenters, painters, plasterers. I mean, there were so many people working on the show that it was just a job managing all that, which was under the jurisdiction of the construction department, but someone needed to be the liaison between what was being built and what was being designed. So my job got really busy because as Larry was concentrating on the design and I was going to sort of manage that for him.
I've never seen anything like it. I quite honestly never had seen sets built like that. It was just an amazing amount of construction that had to be done.
Jerry Parenchio and Bud Yorkin came to the Burbank hangar. We were manufacturing the cars and the furniture, and they walked in and saw this entire hangar filled with people. And I'm telling you, I could see the blood drain out of Bud Yorkin's face. He had no idea what was going on. He couldn't believe it. You're making chairs, you're making, what are you making? Go buy the, you know, buy a chair, buy a table, what are you making? But it was all beautifully designed museum pieces that you can't buy.
I'd always known what the idea of the street was going to be, that everything was going to be very claustrophobic, that the columns, the buildings were going to be out to the edge of the sidewalks, and it was going to be very heavy and very heavy-handed looking. But to see Sid's illustrations when he came back was like, oh my God.
The street set, which has the oblong sort of hot dog-shaped lights around the corner of the building, that was right from the painting, right exactly from the painting. So all these things went together based on sketches from Ridley, direction from him through Lawrence Paul to myself, accompanying Lawrence Paul to the Warner Brothers back lot. Some of those streets have been used in Westerns, I mean, for decades. They were very, very visually familiar.
When I walked on that back lot, it's what it looks like now. When you walk on there, you go down there for lunch, that's what it looked like. And it's got, as all back lots, it can only be limited. So it's limited to, I think, 2, maybe 3 stories, mostly 2. So it's not tall enough. So in those days, because I haven't got digital CGI or anything like that, the decision to do it at night makes a lot of sense. Because I was a designer, I'm up there often. I'm all over Larry, God bless him.
A very good way of telling you how Ridley was in control of the art department is that when the first walkthrough, which we did, of the finished set, when it happened, Ridley sort of walked around and looked at everything else, and he said, that's very good start. Now let's get on with it.
I did a walkthrough backwards on the set, the street set, for one of the publicity release clips. And for me, it was spooky because I was walking through one of my miniature renderings. It was very close to the little painting I'd done for Ridley. And he had Lawrence Paul and the staff essentially come as close as possible to duplicating that design. And it was very, very fascinating and very complimentary, of course, also, that I'd come that close to what he had in his mind as how it should look.
Larry Paul came into my office and said, I want you to come up with two designs for a neon sign, two neon sign designs a day for the next 20 days. And I mean, it was $100,000 worth of neon that I was going to draw. And then they were going to inherit neon from One From the Heart, and they had made a purchase of something, and we were going to use it for the film in a new way. I mean, we weren't going to make it look like it did in their film. I saw a poster that had this katakana or kanji letter form on it, and I said, what does that say? And she said, well, that says origin. And so I turned that form of origin into the neon sign that's behind Deckard when he's looking at the newspaper waiting to get served at the noodle bar. And what the way I perceived it was that I could make it look like a map of the world, because these look like landforms more than they look like letter forms to me, because I don't speak the Japanese. And I chose, you know, orange or pink and blue neon, and you see this glow. And origin is really the question of Blade Runner. It's kind of a hidden little secret that, you know, what is our origin? Where do we come from? Who are we? The thing that was very smart about Ridley Scott was most English-speaking people aren't going to know what it says, but in those characters, it becomes visually very, very important. If you could read it, your eye would go to it and you'd be distracted. You would be looking at it and reading it, and he doesn't want you looking at it and reading it. He just wants you to be dazzled by how beautiful it is.
Deckard's apartment, which is great, I think was a great Frank Lloyd Wright set. We went in the Frank Lloyd Wright house and realized we couldn't really shoot there in practice because I was in there a long time. So Larry and I, he took castings off the walls of the Ennis house.
We had also gone to the Frank Lloyd Wright Ennis Brown house. But when we had gotten to Lloyd Wright's house and I had photographed it, I realized the way the concrete blocks were designed and broken out in coffers, and it literally felt like a cave enclosure. That was the whole tip-off for the whole set. For me, design-wise, it was to make it feel totally claustrophobic.
I designed the interior of Deckard's bedroom, which was supposed to be the ultimate, you know, movable bachelor pad fun pit kind of thing. That was never built.
Some of the things that he did didn't work, and we let him know. It was more Playboy-ish. It belonged in a Playboy magazine conceptual apartment kind of thing as opposed to Blade Runner. I would have discussions with the director, and then I would have to go back and revise not just designs, but revise what they're going to cost me because things got bigger, better, best. So consequently, Deckard's one-bedroom apartment, which was supposed to run $45,000 or $50,000 at that time, ran at that time $175,000. But I'd never budgeted an apartment to cost $175,000. There was never that need. But when I got done with my meetings with Ridley, the need was there.
We were several weeks into the shoot, and I was around, and I was writing pages, and I would rush them over to the set, and sometimes Ridley'd already had a new idea, so my pages were totally outdated before he ever read them. And so, you know, that's the kind of thing that can make you crazy. I brought some pages over to Ridley, right? And in the course of while I was there, they struck for the day, and the lights went off, and there's just this apartment. And I went and I sat down in a chair, and I swear to God, I was in a place that people lived. I mean, that place was so alive and so real. It felt nothing like any set I'd ever been on. And I visited a set of Ridley's some years later when he was doing Someone to Watch Over Me. And I walked into the house that they'd built on a set. And again, little pieces of spaghetti, mold on the wall. It was unbelievably real. I mean, it was true. It was true to life. And that set felt like people lived there.
I went out a couple of nights, and we certainly went out when they weren't shooting and saw the sets and everything. And then right on down the line, from the scenery, the costumes, the entire thing, I think, you know, it speaks for itself.
The people at the studio would walk by or walk through the set as it was being built, and they'd walk through the set and they'd all walk away just shaking their heads saying, "What are these people doing?"
I never chuck away the set or the proscenium or the landscape. The set is the landscape, and to me, in all my work, the landscape and proscenium is a character, sometimes to the irritation of some actors and always to the irritation of critics who tear me apart for many movies before I realize, you know, I have a real advantage. I can actually conceive a world, a universe, and carry it out, so it's real.